Some of you have a strong sense of order and place. You can appreciate that old adage, a place for everything and everything in its place. You might be the kind of person who, when you're standing in front of the shelves in a grocery store, you notice that here is a can that doesn't belong with other kind of canned goods, that it should go here. And you don't work there, and you don't need that product. But you feel compelled to take the can off of here and put it over here on the shelf. Or it might be the kind of person who goes into someone else's home and straightens a picture that's crooked before you sit down. You can understand that adage, a place for everything, and everything in its place. Others of you might be the kind of people who can let your dirty clothes fall on the bathroom floor right next to the hamper and leave them there all day long without even thinking anything about it. And in nature, sometimes these two different people come together, which is always interesting and harmonious. The ancient Israelites had an extremely rigid sense of place and proper structure. It guided the way they viewed the world. It guided the way they saw themselves reflected in the scripture. A sense of who everyone is, what we should be doing within society, and what we should not be doing within society. And if someone or something was out of place, then that was messing with the way they believed God wanted things ordered. Now, we all touch on this to a certain extent, even though we might not think in these sort of stark terms. Imagine that you're on a farm out in a field. You're looking with the farmer at the soil that is dark and rich, the kind of ground that, if it is properly cultivated, can produce a fruitful crop. But then if the farmer walks and takes some of that same soil from his shoes and tracks it into the kitchen, then it becomes unwanted dirt that is swept up and removed from the house. That precious commodity out there in the field becomes unwanted in the kitchen floor. So dirt is soil out of place. The ancient Israelites thought this reflected how we see ourselves and what's happening when someone is suffering from what we would recognize as an illness of some sort. One of the most common that we see throughout Scripture is leprosy, which is a term translated in the Bible that refers to any kind of skin abnormality. And whenever somebody in the ancient world had sores and blisters and things that especially were visible on the outside of the body, to their mind, it looks as if what should be on the inside of the body is pushing through to the outside. The problem is there is something in that person's body that is out of place. And the term that they used for these conditions was unclean. This doesn't have to do with hygiene, but it has to do with a kind of ritualistic, spiritual uncleanness. They believed that when someone displayed these outward signs, it meant that something was out of place in this person's body. And the way to be healed, the way to become whole, was through rituals that would have been conducted by the priest, that brought them into the realm of the whole. They believed that the way to overcome what was visibly an ailment that showed they were out of place was to be brought closer to the holy. They also thought that this applied to other kinds of conditions as well, the kind that cannot be seen. In the gospel passage today, Jesus and the disciples are in Capernaum, and he's gone to the synagogue to teach. And people are amazed at how he teaches, not as someone who understands the law, but who's someone who speaks with great authority. And Mark uses a very particular term to say there was a man who was there who had an unclean spirit. He does not use the term demon, but an unclean spirit. It's Mark's way of saying there was something within this man that was out of place. There was something that did not belong, that was preventing him from being the kind of person he might have felt called to be. And the language is particular because whenever these demons address Jesus, they speak in the plural, suggesting that there's more than one. The man himself does not speak up. And the demons are frightened and troubled with Jesus, and they say, "What have you to do with us?" And then they do what no human up to this point in Mark's gospel has done. They profess him as the Holy One of God. These demons know that once they encounter the holiness of God represented in Jesus Christ, then they will be forced to flee where they do not belong. They will be removed from where they are out of place. You and I have a much more sophisticated knowledge of medical science and the workings of the human body than they did in the ancient world. But we as United Methodists do believe, as our healing service in the Book of Worship states, that all healing comes from God. And healing can take many different forms. Medical professionals and professional counselors who work with other people, they are using their skills and what they have worked so hard to learn and master to do what God called them to do, to participate in God's work of healing. The ancient people, though, also had a way of looking at who we are as much more interconnected than the way we have, since the Age of Enlightenment, sort of divided ourselves up into different parts and categories. The Bible looks at the body, the mind, and the soul as being deeply integrated. All of these are connected together and work with one another. And so we believe that when it comes to healing services, this is another part of God's healing work. It's not a substitute for traditional medicine, but it's a complement. You and I, as people of faith, believe that we are not completely whole unless we have encountered the holiness of God in Jesus Christ. It's also not a magic ritual. It's not the kind of thing that we do that we believe that if we do it just right, then all of our problems go away. But it is first and foremost an expression of faith, a way of saying that we believe that healing and wholeness is ultimately fulfilled when we encounter the holiness of God. If you have an illness or an ailment for a time, it can bring you down, and it can prevent you from doing what you have planned to do. But if you are someone who has dealt with a chronic condition, conditions of the body, that have afflicted you for many years, or perhaps much of your life, or conditions of the mind, or conditions of the heart, the emotions, or if you've dealt with abusive or dysfunctional relationships in some way, things that you just cannot fully control, then you know what it feels like to have some condition take you over and bind you, and prevent you from being able to freely live out your life and express yourself as a person of faith, as we believe God would want us to. This service today is for those who feel they have within them something that is unclean, something that does not belong there, and something that if freed from, we can be fully the men and women God has called us to be. John, in those powerful poetic images in Revelation, talks of a time in which heaven and earth are recreated, and there's no more tears and no more pain. Those things that have bound and possessed us in life are completely eliminated. These services are a foreshadowing of that, that say we believe that a part of what we will experience in whole then is something that we want to encounter now. This service of healing is for those who feel like they have something in them that is out of place, and look to the holiness of God to make us whole and heal us in this time. During this service, in a moment, you will be invited to come down. I will go to the altar and have a prayer of blessing over the oil that we have in front of us. We will have two stations up front. My pastor colleague George will be helping me here, and I will be on this side. And you may come to either one of us that you wish. Music will be played during that time so that you can talk with whichever pastor you go to in private. And you can request whatever you would like healing for. You can be as specific as you like, or you can be general if you prefer. Whenever the anointing for healing is done, the language that's in the book of worship is, "May the indwelling presence of Jesus Christ heal you in body, mind, soul, and relationships, so you may serve God with a joyful heart." So when you come to make your request, you can be specific, or you might want to use one of those categories. I'm here for prayer, for body, for mind, for soul, for relationship. Sometimes I've had people come forward and say, "All of them." We've all been there one time or another. Or you can just say an unspoken. And then, briefly, the pastor and you will pray together for whatever it is you're coming for. And then you'll be anointed. We'll be here for as long as we need to be here. And you're welcome to come down as long as there is still availability. Once we have prayed for and anointed everyone who has come forward, if there's anyone who would like for us to come to you in the pew, if you'll just let the usher know, and they'll let us know to come and pray and anoint you where you are. For all of you who are sitting in the pew during this service, witnessing it and listening to the music that is prayed, be in prayer for those who are coming forward, whether you know the specifics of why that person is coming or not. God does. So please be in prayer for each individual as they come forward. You're invited to join us now in this sacred ritual of healing as we encounter the holiness of God.